Chapter 4. Deep Waters. Stanislas fled from Tokyo. He felt as if he hated the place, as if he never wished to set foot in it again. The evening of the day that Pearl refused him, he wrote to his government requesting leave to return home. But he worked almost single-handed at his legation, and he knew that it would be impossible to take his departure until someone had been sent out to relieve him, a circumstance which meant many months of weary waiting. What might happen during those months, he found himself wondering, as he read over the letter he had written so impetuously. A day, a week, might alter the whole chain of events, and by the time his government had given him permission to take advantage of his leave, making all arrangements to facilitate his departure, he knew that it was more than possible that the idea of throwing up his work and of leaving Japan would be the last desire prominent in his mind. Even in moments of the greatest excitement or of distress, Stanislas, where the question of his work was in any way involved, rarely acted hastily or without looking at the question from all sides. Thus, in the present case, though it would have been impossible for him to have explained the exact reason why, after weighty consideration, he ended up by thrusting the hastily written letter into a drawer, where it reposed peacefully until destroyed many months later. Not that at this moment De Güldenfeldt for one second contemplated asking Mrs. Nugent a second time to become his wife. No thought, indeed, was further from his mind. After much quiet deliberation, indeed considerable hesitation, he had brought himself to the point of making this offer, and greatly to his surprise, disappointment, and distress, he had been refused. He was deeply in love with Pearl, but it must be confessed the sentiment for the moment that had the greatest hold on the spirit of Stanislas de Güldenfeldt, swamping all other feelings, even for the time being, that of his love was that of wounded pride. Stanislas was by no means perfect. His faults were many and manifold, and like all those who from their earliest youth have acted as their own masters, seldom having been crossed in either whims or desires. He was extraordinarily intolerant, even in small matters, of the slightest contradiction or hindrance to his wishes. But when it came to the point of renouncing what he most desired in life, not only for the moment, but he knew well for all futurity, Stanislas was consumed with what was far more than a merely temporary sentiment of annoyance and distress. A great astonishment, a permanent anger and resentment filled his whole being. And his one thought at the present moment was to fly from Pearl and all associations of her, striving his utmost to entirely banish from his mind the woman who had so strangely upset his equanimity. Disarranging so completely his rather settled habits and whole system of life. Thus it was, travelling by slow stages and passing his nights at clean and picturesque tea houses, sleeping on futon, and eating the food on the country, Stanislas and the young interpreter of his legation, Suzuki, his sole companion in his travels, one day found themselves at Sendai, from which place they took the train to Shiogama. There, a sampan, the flat-bottomed junk of the Japanese, was engaged, and for several hours Stanislas, stretched at the bottom of the boat, with hands clasped behind his head and eyes gazing lazily up onto the unclouded sky above, glided in and out through the thousands of lovely islands of this archipelago, so full of mystery and of dreams. Weird and wonderful were those islands, bays, and promontories, in some cases beautiful and entrancing in their wealth of thick-grown pines and rich and varied vegetation, and in others almost uncanny in their bare, naked volcanic rocks, worn into a strange patterns and fantastic shapes by the inroads of the ever-surging sea. Under the late afternoon sun, and across this lovely limpid sea of green, would fade far away in the distance vast and misty ranges of thickly wooded hills, while here and there, gleaming through the soft whiteness of the light, a great peak of purple would arise aloft like a beckoning finger, reaching far beyond into the vast, flying clouds of the faintly shaded sky. On reaching Matsushima, the island of the pines, after this never-to-be-forgotten sail of some delicious hours, and on arriving at the tea house, perched on a rock high above the water, that was to be his shelter for the night. De Güldenfeldt, while the evening meal was being prepared under the supervision of Suzuki, leaned idly over the little barrier of the veranda. He leaned and gazed wonderingly at the beautiful scene, till his whole soul was pervaded by the gentleness, the dreamy passionlessness, the immense repose of the solemn charm of the sight before him. The musically rippling water, the many thousand islands, the fading sunset, with its great shafts of glowing color shooting across the sky, and merging mysteriously into soft and subtle twilight, all had a peculiar beauty and character of their own. It seemed to him like nothing he had ever seen before. No old recollections, no old memories were stirred to his life as his eyes wandered over the waters and dwelt on the many thousand islands of every form and size, now growing shapeless and dim in the darkening shadows of the night. And as he gazed, thus drinking in the beauty of the scene and thinking of nothing, not even for the moment, of Pearl, and as the short twilight gradually faded and night fell, Stanislas was the witness of a strange and picturesque sight. Thousands and thousands of dazzling lights were shimmering on the surface of the dark, calm sea before him, each light growing gradually fainter and fainter and gliding further and further away into the open. Then it was that the dear Güldenfeldt remembered that it was the sacred and yearly ceremony of the Shoryobune, or the launching of the ships of the souls, when thousands of little skiffs and barks, each illuminated with a single lantern, are once a year set afloat upon the open sea by the simple fisherfolk. On this date, the ocean is not, for the time being, but one vast highway of the dead, whose passing souls must cross the waters, be they rough or calm, to eventually reach the haven of their distant and eternal home. Now gleaming on the crest of the wave, now disappearing beneath the waters, those fires of the dead take their onward, uncertain journey. Sad indeed is the fate of the lost, lamenting soul, whose little craft with its twinkling light is submerged and extinguished by the scudding spray of the sea, disappearing forever from all human sight and ken. For that poor struggling spirit is no rest, nor eternal repose, forever and forever will it be an outcast and a wanderer, hovering on the shores of that land in which Nirvana is found, but fated never to dwell within the regions of its blessed calm and peace. It is said that as these ghostly lights take their strange and onward journey across the sea, the distant murmur of many voices is heard like the mournful roar of the surf beating on the strand. The language uncomprehended and indistinguishable of those many thousand weary souls. Struggling on towards their long prayed for, long expected haven of peace and holy contemplation. And as De Güldenfeldt gazed out thus far before him, his eye became fixed upon one little glimmer dancing up and down on the water, and a cry above the murmur of the many voices seemed to him to come from the direction of that light. Stanislas could not tear his eyes away from his distant gleam, nor shut his ears to the sound of that cry, so faint and weak, and yet so strangely dominant over all other sounds around him. And as he looked, fascinated and engrossed, the fancy seized him that it was even at the spectacle of his own striving, weary soul he was gazing, and that the wail that proceeded from that flickering light, rising and falling across the waters, was the echo of the cry of desolation and despair that had filled and rent his heart. Ever since the day he had parted from Pearl Nugent in anger and bitter disillusion. He leaned further over the balcony, trying to pierce the gloom and to follow the wind-fraught vagaries of that one faint glimmering light. Now it tore swiftly along, now it rose high above the waves, seeming to challenge with its swift and triumphant haste the more backward competitors in this strenuous race, of which the distant goal was the stormy and open sea. It disappeared for the space of an instant, and dreading that it was engulfed forever by the waters, Stanislas's heart sank within him. Ah, no, there it was again, solitary and triumphant, shining like a colossal diamond, far, far away, as far as eye could see. Alone it was, reaching a great distance beyond the others, and De Güldenfeldt felt grieved for this flickering, uncertain light, always solitary, always struggling, however much it was in advance, or appeared to have vanquished those who had first started with it in the race. It was, therefore, with a certain glow of joy, a sentiment of excitement, which he made no effort to suppress, that he finally perceived another distant light, yet as luminous and as steady as the first, flying with all speed over the suddenly roughening ocean, every instant approaching nearer to the brilliant spark that for so long had remained triumphantly mistress of the seas. Stanislas, without hesitation, joyously decided in his own mind that this second light could be none other than the soul light of Pearl. For as it gained on the distant gleam, the faint piteous cry that had hitherto proceeded from the latter ceased, and the light stood still on the face of the waters. And Stanislas knew that his own expectant spirit was waiting for Pearl's soul to join it. Swifter and swifter it flew, nearer and nearer it came, gaining every moment on that other trembling light that was pausing on the crest of the wave to bear it company on that rough and onward journey. Stanislas felt assured that just one faint effort more, one short critical moment, would join in happy and eternal union these two distant lights. But as he gazed breathlessly, the light which he called Pearl's soul, for one brief second gleamed up high into the horizon, gave a faint wavering flicker, and the surface that an instant before was all aglow with its vaporous brilliancy grew as dark as the inky night that so suddenly seemed to envelop all things, and the little spark engulfed by the waters vanished forever from all human sight. And there still remained his light, his soul, solitary and forlorn, drifting aimlessly on and on. Once again, Stanislas caught the sound from far across the waters of that moaning cry, that piteous, faint lament, the echo of the desolation in his own heart. And the wail rang in his ears till the light on the sea, growing smaller and smaller and fainter, finally merged into the distant horizon and was seen no more. I wonder what is coming to me, sighed De Güldenfeldt. As reluctantly stirring from the balcony, he sat himself down on the pile of cushions prepared for him on the tatami. I am as sentimental, as great a fool as any boy indulging in his first attack of calf love. Yet and yet, I wish to God Pearl's light had not gone out, but had succeeded in eventually reaching mine. It would somehow have seemed more reassuring, a better omen for the future. Whereas now, Stanislas de Güldenfeldt passed a bad night. The tea house, famous for its lovely and extensive view, but for little else, was by no means the haven of rest he had hoped for. The celebration of a geisha feast in the next room, with all its accompaniments of cheerful voices, rippling laughter, and the doubtful charms of the music of the samisen, destroyed through the earlier hours of the night all thoughts of repose. When at length the last convivial guest, after many oyasumi nasai, had finally taken his departure, Stanislas found his cost that his futon were both hard and lumpy, and that the Japanese green mosquito net, perforated with holes, seemed expressly fabricated to admit scores of those wily and vicious insects, with which his tussles were many and necessarily totally unsuccessful. He tossed and turned, dozed for a few minutes, and in his uneasy dreams was haunted by the soul lights. Now dancing on the waves, now taking weird shapes of grotesque birds of prey, or fish and animals of no known description, they seemed to imperiously beckon him to join them, or enveloping him in a strange, uncanny arms. They dragged his struggling form far beneath the waters. Finally, he no longer could support in patience the discomfort of his room or these weird nightmares of an excited brain. And rising from his lowly couch and pushing open the amado, he looked out into the night. The moon was full, illuminating with its bright glory the calm sea from which all the lights had long since vanished, and from the surface of which the islands rose from out the water like great gaps blackened by mysterious and ever-moving shadows. On the right, partly hidden by its sacred groves, approached by the red torii, resting almost on the water's edge, stood bathed in a mystic light, the ancient and picturesque shrine. This lovely little shrine was entirely framed by one immense cedar, whose great branches, motionless in the silent night air, stretched far beyond, like dark angels guarding the consecrated ground. Not a living creature was to be seen, and with the exception of the hum of the night insects, all was as silent as the aged moss-grown tombstones on which the moonbeams fell in a ghostly streaks of light.
Oh.
heavenly orb, whose pale but magic light sheds liquid glory through the realms of night. O pathless wanderer, whose holy gleam enshrines the heavens around with silvery beam. Dear to my longing heart, thy wondrous ray, kindling pure thoughts that shun the glaring day. Here while I pensive kneel, gazing above, thy silver sheen melts wild thoughts into love. And radiant dreams and hopes and fancies roll in wildering rapture through my restless soul. Shined on, mild, mystic moon, 8 tears to cease through my sad heart, shed thy calm light of peace. The simple verse was the composition of the English mother he had adored, and the repetition of it so appropriate to the sweet scene before Stanislaus' eyes, tended greatly towards bestowing that repose which till now had eluded his weary yet restless mind. But the beauty and peace and silence were not to last. A shadow fell across the surface of the moon, and a fitful and mysterious wind wailed from behind the hills. Suddenly, with no previous warning, every cur in every little hamlet from far and near commenced a discordant and incessant barking. Before Stanislaus could ask himself what meant this unwelcome disturbance of the calm night, a premonitory trembling of the wooden veranda on which he stood warned him that all the terrors of an earthquake were before him. There was no time to realize this disagreeable fact before another shock followed the first, more violent and more prolonged, then a third, in which the wood, creaking, rose like the waves of the ocean from beneath his feet. Stanislaus found himself clinging to the bamboo rails of the veranda, watching with a strange fascination the branches of the sacred cedar waving violently backwards and forwards as if shaken by the force of a tempest, and the red torii beyond trembling in its balance. The shock continued, each second increasing the violence thereof, till with a deafening roar, like the roar of the ocean, with one stupendous and prolonged crash, the frail building, sliding from its slight foundations, collapsed like a house of cards. Stanislaus remembered no more until he found himself stretched on the ground outside all that now remained of the once picturesque tea house. A few yards further and he would have been over the cliff. As it was, he was on his feet in a moment, feeling none the worse for his fall, which had been from no great height, and was broken by the heap of stones and rubbish on which he fell. The house was a mass of ruins. Such indeed, as soon as his somewhat dazed condition allowed him to look around him, seemed to be the melancholy condition of most of the miniature matchbox habitations that 3 minutes before had stood edging the sea in all their simple and romantic beauty. The torii that he had admired so short a time ago, bathed in the calm moonlight, now lay prone on the ground, while half the roof of the little shrine had vanished in a cloud of dust. Only remained the great and ancient cedar to compete against and triumphantly conquer many another revolution of angry nature. This noble tree had survived hundreds of years of earth oscillations and currents, tidal waves and earthquakes, volcanic agencies to which, we are told, Japan itself owes her very being? Doubtless of the same terrible and disastrous causes, perhaps today, perhaps tomorrow, perhaps only in the far distant ages to come, will this beautiful fairyland owe her ultimate destruction. Goldenfeld's first thoughts in the chaos that followed was of his young interpreter, Suzuki. He shouted his name aloud, but in the din and confusion, and the chorus of wails and weepings over lost property, and Alice, in many cases, lost dear ones, his voice was unheard. He knew the boy had been sleeping in the room next to his own, but that little room was now with the rest of the building, heaped on the ground, a mass of ruins. Calling on some of the fishermen who were standing by him stupefied by the scene of the bitter desolation before them, he tore wildly at the debris of planks and paper and matting piled on the ground, feeling sure that he had but to persevere long enough to find him for whom he searched. In far too short a space of time, in lifting a heavy beam of wood, the body of this dear companion of his travels was discovered beneath, motionless and dead. From the first, indeed, a presentiment of coming evil had warned Stanislas he would thus find him. The moon, once more unclouded and brilliant, lit up the boy's good-looking face and slim young form. Still resting on his futon, there was an expression of such complete peace and happiness on his countenance that for a moment it was indeed difficult not to consider as merely slumbering this youth hurled thus suddenly into eternity. De Güldenfeldt raised the burden so light and delicate in his arms, and pushing away the dark hair from the brow, he perceived a deep jagged cut on the temple. That wound in itself was enough to cause instant death. The blood had ceased to flow with the ceasing of the heart throbs, and as his eyes lingered sadly on the inanimate form within his arm, the tears welled up into De Güldenfeldt's eyes. He had loved this young man born at the legation and educated at the French school, the worthy son of a noble samurai, who himself, after the revolution and on the loss of his fortune, had in years gone by been only too grateful to accept the situation of interpreter at the Swedish legation. From the first day that Stanislas had held the post of minister in Japan, this youth, unusually quick and intelligent, had proved not only his companion, but his right hand. He had returned the affection of this master with the fidelity and devotion of his race, had accompanied him in his many travels throughout the country, was an excellent interpreter, and had directed his household with the thoroughness and conscientiousness of an upright and honest man, devoted to his master's interests. De Güldenfeldt felt that in losing this bright and intelligent companion of many lonely hours, he was losing half himself. "One shall be taken and the other left," he murmured, as unrestrained the tears fell. Indeed, the ways of Providence are strange. Why has this lad, so full of promise and with all before him, been the one taken, while I, a lonely man, with no hold on life, no ties, no inducements to keep me here, am the fortunate one that is left? And the next day, during the sad process of cremation, when after 3 brief hours, all that was left of this charming companion of years was a handful of ashes and a few splinters of bone, Stanislas, with a feeling of intense loss and desolation, again asked himself that question. Why was he the one whom Providence had chosen to continue the strife? "No one cares for me. No one wants me," he thought, as he sadly supervised the placing of the ashes in the urn. And to this day, those ashes repose and have incense and flowers offered before them in the grounds of the great temple of the Goya-san.